Hello, welcome to the course on Hadoop development offered by DataRaj Academy. My name is Venu, and in today's session, we will continue our discussion on Hadoop 1.x architecture. I hope you will all find this session interesting and informative. In the earlier session, we discussed about HDFS framework. In this session, we will start with MapReduce and we will discuss its relation with Hadoop. We will continue to see various server roles in a Hadoop cluster. Finally, we will see the various installation modes of Hadoop. So, let's get started. Now, what is MapReduce? MapReduce is a style or model of processing parallelizable problems across large datasets using a large number of computers, collectively referred to as a cluster. MapReduce is a programming strategy which adopts split-apply-combine strategy for data analysis. An important point to be noted is that this split-apply-combine strategy cannot be applied to all the problems. When the dataset is small, it is not a good idea to resort to parallel processing. We can process that small dataset using a single computer. Only when the size of the dataset is large, we resort to parallel processing using a cluster of computers. Parallel processing will result in faster processing, and that is what is important for us when dealing with big data. But parallel processing and distributed processing are complex because there is a network of computers involved and many issues have to be addressed along with our actual business problem. Secondly, many problems can be solved by parallel processing. Let us try to understand this with a very simple example. Let us imagine we have 1,000 registered students in our online training portal. We would like to know how many out of these 1,000 students have at least 10 years of IT experience and who have at least 2 years of experience in Hadoop development. This is our problem. Though 1,000 is a pretty small number to deal with, we will try to solve it using parallel processing. And more importantly, we will do it the MapReduce way. This solution and approach holds good even if the number increases to 10,000 or 1 billion students. MapReduce is a split apply combine strategy for data analysis. MapReduce is a technique that splits big datasets into many smaller ones, processes each small dataset separately but simultaneously on different servers or computers, then gather and aggregate the intermediate results of all the subprocesses to produce the final answer. Such a distributed architecture allows us to process big datasets many times faster than traditional non-distributed designs. Coming back to our example, we will split this larger dataset containing data of 1,000 students into 4 smaller datasets, each containing data of 250 students. These 4 small datasets are to be processed in parallel by picking 4 computers from a cluster of computers. In the first filter, we will apply a logic to screen the students who have 10 years of IT experience. The same filter logic is applied to all the smaller datasets in the first phase. Each of the 4 computers yield results which are not final results. They are intermediate results. The intermediate results from the 4 computers are combined together and processed together again. Second filter has to be applied to screen the students who have 2 years of experience in Hadoop development. The filter is applied on all the intermediate results, and this ultimately yields final results. The phase where we applied the first filter is called map phase, and the final phase that yielded final results is called reduce phase. Doesn't it look very simple? Yes, it does look simple, but only because we have discussed just about the business logic, which is screening students with 10 years of IT experience and with 2 years of Hadoop development experience. Other than this business logic, as a programmer, we need to take care of many other tasks related to parallel processing and distributed processing. When the larger dataset is divided into 4 smaller parts and distributed across the cluster, as a programmer, we have to identify on which nodes or computers these parts are residing. Once identified, we need to package our first filter business logic code to those nodes. We need to process each small dataset separately but simultaneously on different servers. Once the computers yield the intermediate results, we need to gather them and apply the second filter logic. Additionally, what happens if one of the node fails? Luckily, by design, Hadoop maintains replicas of the datasets. We need to run the failed process again on the node on which there is a replica of the dataset. There could be network latencies which we as a programmer need to handle. On which nodes map phase and reduce phase should run is a critical decision to make, and it's a daunting task to be addressed by the programmer. There are many other distributed computing related complexities that should be handled, which are very challenging even to an expert programmer. Now, does it sound simple? It certainly does not. This is where MapReduce framework comes to our rescue. Hadoop's MapReduce framework takes care of all the plumbing work that is supposed to be taken care of by the programmer. Now, what is a framework? In general, a framework provides a standard way to build and deploy applications. A software framework is a universal reusable software environment that provides particular functionality as part of a larger software platform to facilitate development of software applications, products, and solutions. Software frameworks may include support programs, compilers, code libraries, tool sets, and application programming interfaces that bring together all the different components to enable development of an application or a project or a system. Software frameworks aim to facilitate software developments by allowing designers and programmers to devote their time to meet actual business requirements rather than dealing with the more standard low-level details of providing a working system, thereby reducing overall development time. For example, a team using a web framework to develop a banking website can focus on writing code particular to banking processes rather than the mechanics of request handling and state management. Coming back to our example, the programmer can focus on developing filter logics rather than handling the mechanics of distributed computing. Filter logics in our case are simple, but in real world cases, they are not. It takes a lot of effort and prudence from the programmer to develop map and reducer logics. Even in our simple example, a diligent programmer can apply the filter logics more wisely. Common sense says, number of students having 2 years of experience in Hadoop development will be a lot more lesser than the number of students having 10 years of IT experience. So, if we apply the filter of Hadoop experience in map phase, the intermediate result dataset is a lot more smaller. This ultimately results in faster processing of the smaller dataset in the reduce phase, which screens out students having 10 years of IT experience. There is lesser network input-output calls due to this smaller intermediate data. Let us note down a set of basic guiding rules to data scientists or data analysts or any programmer who is involved in processing of data. Knowing the source of the data helps. It gives us an idea of the volume, velocity, and other key aspects of the data. If the data is generated by some application, knowing about the users or user base of that application helps. It might throw some important insights into the age factor and geographical locations of them. In case of big data, taking a sample dataset to understand its structure and composition will help a lot. The bottom line is, it is recommended to understand the source, nature, and type of data before doing some kind of data analysis. In MapReduce programming, developers write jobs that consist primarily of a map function and a reduce function. The framework handles all the gory and low-level details of parallelizing the work, scheduling parts of the job on worker machines, monitoring for and recovering from failures, and so forth. Developers are shielded from having to implement complex and repetitious code and instead allows the developers to focus on algorithms and business logic. User-provided code is invoked by the framework. This is much like Java application servers that invoke servlets upon receiving an HTTP request. The container is responsible for setup and teardown as well as providing a runtime environment for user-supplied code. Just as servlet authors need not implement the low-level details like socket programming, event handling loops, and complex thread coordination, MapReduce developers program to a well-defined simple APIs and the MapReduce framework does all the heavy lifting behind the screen. The client submits a MapReduce job to the MapReduce framework. MapReduce framework decomposes the job into map tasks and reduce tasks and schedules them for remote execution on the slave nodes. The idea of MapReduce was defined in a paper written by two Google engineers in 2004. The paper describes both the programming model and parts of Google's specific implementation of the framework. Hadoop MapReduce is an open source implementation of the model described in this paper and tracks the implementation closely. It is specifically developed to deal with large-scale workloads. MapReduce framework is a batch-based distributed computing framework modeled after Google's paper on MapReduce. It allows us to parallelize work over a large amount of raw data. This type of work, which could take days or longer using conventional serial programming techniques, can be reduced down to minutes using MapReduce on a Hadoop cluster. The MapReduce framework simplifies parallel processing by abstracting away the complexities involved in working with distributed systems, such as parallelization of computation, work distribution among nodes, and dealing with unreliable hardware and software. With this abstraction, MapReduce framework allows the programmer to focus on addressing business needs rather than getting tangled up in distributed system complications. MapReduce framework decomposes jobs submitted by a client into small parallelized map and reduce tasks. In the first phase, map tasks are launched across a set of slave nodes. The intermediate output is gathered to reprocess it. In the second phase, reduced tasks are launched, which finally yields the output. The map and reduce constructs used in MapReduce are borrowed from those found in the Lisp functional programming language and use a shared nothing model to remove any parallel execution interdependencies that could add unwanted synchronization points or state sharing. A shared nothing architecture is a distributed computing concept that represents the notion that each node is independent and self-sufficient. There are few scenarios where MapReduce programming model cannot be employed. If the computation of a value depends on previously computed values, then MapReduce cannot be used. One good example is the Fibonacci series, where each value is summation of the previous two values. MapReduce works very well in contexts where variables or observations are processed one by one. For instance, we analyze 1 terabyte of text data and we want to compute the frequencies of all keywords found in our data. We can divide the 1 terabyte data into 1000 datasets, each 1 gigabyte. Now, we produce 1000 keyword frequency tables, one for each subset, and aggregate them to produce a final table. However, when we need to process variables or datasets jointly, that is 2x2 or 3x3, MapReduce offers no benefit over non-distributed architectures. One must come with a more sophisticated solution. So, will MapReduce solve all our data problems? Well, if we can rewrite our algorithms as maps and reduces, then yes. If not, then no. It is not a silver bullet to all the problems of scale. It is just one of the good techniques to work on large sets of data when we can work on small pieces of the data set in parallel. MapReduce refers to two distinct things: the programming model, which we discussed until now, and the specific implementation of the framework, like MapReduce framework in Hadoop. There are two major daemons in Hadoop MapReduce framework: the job tracker and the task tracker. The job tracker is the master process responsible for accepting job submissions from clients, scheduling tasks to run on slave nodes, and providing administrative functions such as monitoring the health of slave nodes and also monitor the task progress on a cluster. There is one job tracker per MapReduce cluster running on a node which can be called as a master node. Task trackers are the slave processes of MapReduce framework. There are multiple task trackers in a Hadoop cluster. A task tracker process will be running on every slave node of a Hadoop cluster. Just like the relationship between HDFS slave daemon's data nodes and the HDFS master daemon name node, task trackers are the slave daemons of MapReduce, which inform the master daemon, the job tracker, as to their current health and status by way of regular heartbeats. Clients and task trackers communicate with the job tracker by way of remote procedure calls. In short, they are called RPCs. The job tracker is the master service within Hadoop that distributes MapReduce tasks to specific nodes in the cluster, ideally the nodes that have data, or at least are in the same rack. Client applications submit jobs to the job tracker. The job tracker talks to the name node to determine the location of the data. The job tracker locates task tracker nodes with available computing resources at or near the data. The job tracker submits the work to the chosen task tracker nodes. The task tracker nodes are monitored. If they do not submit heartbeat signals often enough, they are deemed to have failed and the work is scheduled on a different task tracker. A task tracker will notify the job tracker when a task fails. The job tracker decides what to do then. It may resubmit the job elsewhere, or it may mark that specific record as something to avoid, or it may even blacklist the task tracker as unreliable. When the work is completed, the job tracker updates its status. Client applications can poll the job tracker for information. The job tracker process is a point of failure for the Hadoop MapReduce service. That is, if it goes down, all running jobs will be halted. Hence, job tracker is usually hosted on a high-end reliable hardware, since a failure of the master process will result in the failure of all running jobs. The act of deciding which tasks of a job should be executed on which slave nodes is referred to as task scheduling. This is not scheduling in the way that the cron daemon executes jobs at given times, but instead, it is more like the way the operating system schedules CPU process time. In case of a single standalone computer, operating system allocates system resources to run jobs. Similarly, tasks in a MapReduce cluster share worker node resources or space. But instead of context switching, that is, pausing the execution of a task to give another task time to run in case of OS CPU time sharing, in a MapReduce cluster, when a task executes, it executes completely. Understanding task scheduling and, by extension, resource allocation and sharing is so important that we will dedicate an entire session to those topics. Similar to the storage daemons of HDFS, the computing daemons also follow a master-slave architecture. The job tracker is the master process overseeing the overall execution of a MapReduce job, and the task trackers manage the execution of individual tasks on each slave node. The task tracker on each node accepts task assignments from the job tracker, instantiates the user code, executes those tasks locally, and reports progress back to the job tracker periodically. There is always a single task tracker on each worker node. Both task trackers and data nodes run on the same machines, which makes each node both a compute node and a storage node respectively. After a client calls the job tracker to begin a data processing job, the job tracker partitions the work and assigns different map and reduce tasks to each task tracker in the cluster. A task tracker is a process in the cluster that accepts tasks from a job tracker. Tasks could be map tasks or reduce tasks. Every task tracker is configured with a set of slots. These indicate the number of tasks that it can accept. When the job tracker tries to find some slave node to schedule a task as part of a MapReduce job, it first looks for an empty slot on the same server where the data which is to be processed is residing. If not found, job tracker will keep looking for empty slots on servers where replicas of data are residing. Only when all such servers are busy, job tracker will look for an empty slot on a machine in the same rack. So job tracker, in this way, tries to minimize the network input-output calls. When the task finishes, successfully or not, the task tracker notifies the job tracker. The task trackers also send out heartbeat messages to the job tracker, usually every few minutes, to reassure the job tracker that they are still alive. These messages also inform the job tracker of the number of available slots so the job tracker can stay up to date with where in the cluster work can be delegated. Rather than panic when things go wrong, MapReduce is desired to treat failures as common and has very well defined semantics for dealing with the inevitable. With tens, hundreds, or even thousands of machines making up a Hadoop cluster, machines, and especially hard disks, fail at a significant rate. It's not uncommon to find that approximately 2 to 5% of the nodes in a large Hadoop cluster have some kind of fault, meaning they are operating either suboptimally or simply not at all. In addition to faulty servers, there can sometimes be errant user MapReduce jobs, network failures, and even errors in the data. Failures can happen at different levels. Task failures on a slave node are quite common. In case of task failure, tasks can be rescheduled on other available slots of the same slave node. Even failure of task tracker process as a whole is common. It could even be due to some hardware failure of the slave node. In this case, the slave node becomes unavailable. The tasks already running on that node will fail, and the job tracker will reschedule them on some other available slave nodes. The unavailable slave node will be marked as dead, and no new tasks will be assigned. The more critical failure is the job tracker process or the master node failure. In this case, all the running jobs will fail and we cannot run new jobs. Ultimately, name node process failure is the most critical failure, in which case the metadata of the file system becomes unavailable and data cannot be accessed anymore. It is very common for tasks to fail for a variety of reasons. Incorrect or poorly implemented user code, unexpected data problems, temporary machine failures, and administrative intervention are a few of the more common causes. When a failure is detected by the task tracker, it is reported to the job tracker in the next heartbeat. The job tracker, in turn, notes the task failure and, if additional attempts are permitted, reschedules the task to run. The default limit is 4 attempts. The task may be run either on the same machine or on another machine in the cluster, depending on available capacity or slots. Should multiple tasks from the same job fail on the same task tracker repeatedly, the task tracker is added to a job-level blacklist that prevents any other tasks from the same job from executing on the task tracker in question. If multiple tasks from different jobs repeatedly fail on a specific task tracker, the task tracker in question is added to a global blacklist for 24 hours, which prevents any tasks from being scheduled on the task tracker for the set time. The next obvious failure condition is the loss of the task tracker daemon itself, or the failure of the entire slave node. The job tracker, after a configurable amount of time with no heartbeats from a specific task tracker, will consider the task tracker dead along with any tasks it was assigned. Tasks are rescheduled and will execute on another task tracker. All the while, the client application is completely shielded from the internal failure, and as far as it is concerned, the job appears to simply slow down for some time while tasks are retried. The loss of job tracker is more severe in Hadoop MapReduce. Should the job tracker fail, meaning either the process or the machine on which it runs fail, its internal state about currently executing jobs is lost. Even if it immediately recovers, all running tasks will eventually fail. This effectively means the job tracker is a single point of failure for the MapReduce layer, a limitation of Hadoop 1.x MapReduce. For jobs whose input or output dataset is on HDFS, it's possible that HDFS could experience a failure. If a data node process fails, any task that is currently reading from it or writing to it will follow the standard HDFS error handling procedure or mechanism. When all data nodes containing a block and its replicas fail during a read, or when the name node cannot find any data nodes on which to place a block during a write, the HDFS read and write operations will fail. Additionally, if the name node isn't available, metadata of the file system becomes unavailable, so there is no question of running any jobs. In the next session, we will discuss about the Hadoop cluster components and the various Hadoop installation modes. Finally, we want to hear from you. As the viewer of this tutorial, you are our most important critic and commentator. We value your opinion and want to know what we are doing right, what we could do better, and any other words of wisdom you are willing to pass our way. We welcome your comments. Your feedback will be enormously helpful in improvising the final shape of this course. So please subscribe to the DataRaj channel and contribute any questions, comments, or suggestions in the comment section below. Thank you.